All right, almost there. Can you hear me, Layla?
Yes, I
Great.
can.
Good. All right, let me start. Good afternoon, and welcome to our book discussion of Governing the Feminist Peace, the Vitality and Failure of the Women, Peace, and Security Agenda, written by Professor Laura Shepherd and Dr. Paul Kirby. My name is Karen Johnston, and I'm the Research Director at WISE. We are pleased that you have joined us for what I know will be a lively and very relevant discussion. Women in International Security, pronounced WISE, has long been a beacon for gender equality, breaking barriers for women leaders in the international security sector. For nearly four decades, WISE has empowered women globally through professional development, mentorship, research, and policy engagement. Our network spans nearly 60 countries and includes over 15,000 individuals committed to closing the gender gap in peace and security. If you want to learn more about our organization and join us as a member, please visit our website. The link will be in the chat. For today's book talk, we are joined by one of the authors, Dr. Paul Kirby from London. We are so grateful you were willing to speak with us today despite the late hour. This is a particularly relevant time to discuss governing the feminist peace. Last week, the UN Security Council met for the 24th open debate on the WPS agenda, and next year will be the 25th anniversary of the adoption of UN Security Council Resolution 1325. We have seen advancement toward women's full, equal, and meaningful participation in peace processes and political solutions, but many experts feel the implementation of the WPS agenda has stalled. Next year's 25th anniversary and the question of the future of the WPS agenda will serve as the organizing theme for WISE's research, publications, and external outreach over the next 12 months to build momentum and opportunities to bring WPS into the public debate in the months leading up to the 25th anniversary. We can use this time to begin serious deliberations about what will be needed to reanimate the international community's commitment to closing the global gender gap. We could not have had a more timely event than this book talk, which offers a critical account of the WPS agenda, its vitality and failure, as the authors put it, and asks us to fundamentally reconceptualize how we have viewed the agenda over the last nearly 25 years. So allow me to welcome and introduce our distinguished speaker, Dr. Paul Kirby. You will find a link to more detailed biographies of both authors in the chat. Dr. Paul Kirby is a reader in international politics at the Institute for Humanities and Social Sciences, the School of Politics and International Relations, the University of London. His research interests lie in gender governance, statecraft, pop culture, critical war studies, and IR theory and meta theory. Dr. Kirby is currently a co-director of the GCRF Gender, Justice, and Security Hub, a multinational interdisciplinary research consortium investigating the politics of gender justice and inclusive peace. Dr. Kirby, your book is very stimulating and challenging because it asks the WPS peace and security community to abandon the traditional view of WPS as a singular political project or vision. You write that instead of accepting WISE as a settled, cohesive policy and framework for achieving gender equality and peace and security governance, we must forget WPS and instead engage with the agenda as a field in flux. Specifically, you ask us and your readers what would happen if we abandoned the idea of women, peace, and security as a unified political project. This is indeed a very provocative question, and so we look forward to your presentation. Thank you. The floor is yours.
Thank you so much, Karen, and so wonderful to be with all of you. Let me just begin by attempting a screen share, and let me hope that it works and is visible to all. Is it?
Yes, it is.
Fantastic. Okay, well then I'll begin. So today I'm going to present on our new book, which Karen has already so kindly mentioned, Governing the Feminist Peace, which is, as you will see, co-authored with Laura Shepherd from the University of Sydney. Now, Laura can't be with us today, but as many of you might know, she has been at the forefront of WPS, that's Women, Peace and Security, scholarship for almost 2 decades now. I think she was one of the first, if not the first person to write a doctoral dissertation on WPS when there was still only one resolution, when we still only had 1325. So I want to emphasize from the start that this is a collaborative work, not just to share the responsibility for anything you might like or dislike in what I say, but also to avoid as much as I can the impression that I am here to mansplain WPS to all of you, many of whom I know will be practitioners in this space and therefore have your own deep, rich experience and views of what the agenda has been and what the agenda can become. So that said, I'm sure many people know what Women, Peace and Security or WPS is, but in brief, it is the formal name that is given to an entire policy and governance agenda, normally dated to October 2000 and Security Council Resolution 1325. And it's an agenda which deals with gender equality in all aspects of war and peace making. So that's normally situated within the United Nations system, but this is an agenda that is now taken up in over 100 countries and dozens of regional bodies. And part of what the book is about is thinking about that spread and that pluralization of the agenda. So who owns WPS is partly what is in question, but it's also worth saying at the start that there is a large degree of contention about every aspect of that summary phrase I used, right? So what gender equality entails and what qualifies as war and peace making. Now, Governing the Feminist Peace, our book, is an academic effort to analyze 20 years of WPS. We finished it a couple of years after the 20th anniversary, of course, as Karen mentioned, we're coming up to the 25th. It took about 7 years for us to write it from conception to completion. It's out now. It came out in April, so we're very happy to see it in the world. And what we're basically doing, Laura and I, in the book, is asking a deceptively simple question, which is, what is the WPS agenda anyway? Unlike most of the other scholarly texts on the agenda, we were perhaps foolish in trying to take in as many of the different sites and as many of the dimensions of WPS as we could do across those first 2 decades. So it's quite a long book, and it can be quite detailed, although I hope not too dense and thick. So what I'm going to try and do in these introductory remarks before we get into some dialogue is to run over the outline of the argument in the book, supported by some of the images that we reproduce in it. And the way I would maybe summarize that kind of that prompt, that question for us is, how do we capture the global circuit that we call WPS, both in its generality and in all of its particularity? So one clue is in our subtitle to the book, which is to look at the conjoined fortunes of vitality and failure and how these two things go together in the history of WPS. So this, as you can see, is a visual account of 20 years of the agenda produced by some of the members of ICANN, the International Civil Society Action Network, expressing their own diverse journeys through WPS, through the agenda. And you'll see in some of the parts that I've pulled out, here is a section around the beginning of the agenda in which you'll see descriptions and articulations of statements made at world summits, of trainings offered by ICANN members in 1325 and CEDAW, and of course, most prominently, the start of the War on Terror. By the time we get to 2020, you're seeing women's mediator networks, the rise of some queer rights symbolism, activism on femicide, legal advocacy, and again, the persistent realities of extremism and counter-extremism. So for Laura and I, the task was how to make sense of the great success and the huge spread of WPS in geographical and thematic terms, but also to think critically about the constant refrain, and I think if you work in WPS space, this will be familiar to you, that implementation is failing, that political will is lacking, that the true spirit of the agenda is being co-opted, securitized, displaced, colonized, abandoned, betrayed, and so on. So there's this sense that 1325 was, in Nina Lahoud's words, a revolutionary outcome that is yet to trigger a revolutionary change. So, in some senses, our book is also a new take on what Diane Otto, the feminist scholar, famously called the power and the danger of WPS. So, Otto was thinking of power and danger as they existed for feminists, particularly around the founding of the agenda. And that was the power and danger around the Security Council. So, both a set of opportunities to push for feminist change, but also a series of traps in dealing with great powers and states. So, vitality and failure are somewhat like power and danger, but speak to some still larger dynamics as we see them in the agenda. So, what was our basic motivation in starting this in this project and in pushing for what Karen referred to there as a reconceptualization of the agenda? Well, essentially, it was a dissatisfaction with the reigning view of WPS, mainly in academia, but I would say also in a wide range of practice, which is the norm perspective. And many, if not most, WPS scholars understand the agenda as a norm, as a series of norms, or as a supernorm. And exactly what we mean by a norm varies. Usually, as academics, we would say a standard of appropriate behavior. But there's disagreement about how strictly that needs to be adhered to and by who. But in short, the idea is that the Security Council agreed a broad set of rules about gender equality, and through subsequent resolutions and national and regional action plans and other state commitments, those rules were supposed to be followed by all relevant international actors. So WPS would then be something like a landmine nuclear or chemical weapons ban, where there is a high level of adherence from states, where violations are rare, and where states or other actors are harshly punished or stigmatized when violations happen. Right? So hence the image of the late Princess Diana and the success, particularly in the late 90s, around more or less eradicating landmines as a tool of war. But we would say that there are a number of problems with this perspective, with the norm perspective. Basically, the first is that basically none of the norms that we think of as WPS in terms of the pillars of participation, protection, prevention, and relief and recovery, with the very partial and arguable exception of sexual violence prohibitions, basically none of the norms that make up WPS are indeed effective constraints on behavior. And we can get into more detail about how we arrive at that conclusion, but effectively, the norms are not functioning. The second trouble that we had with this norms perspective is that, to our eye, norm language has a tendency to reproduce a kind of Eurocentric and simplistic account of diffusion, in which essentially actors in the global north come up with a set of ideas and rules, and then gradually over time, those are diffused out into the wider international system, sometimes with various local adaptations. And we found that kind of account quite problematic. And then, third, we were troubled by the fact that when you label everything a form of norm contestation, which is one of the ways that scholars deal with these complexities, what you end up is a situation in which norms both explain too little, in that they are aspirations and campaigns rather than effective constraints, and explain too much, in that every single action that's taken in the name of WPS can be labeled as a kind of norm activity. So that's maybe a little bit inside baseball in terms of the scholarly debates, but that was kind of the negative piece, what we were responding against. And so what we set out to do instead was to try and think about WPS differently. And the language, the model that we use for doing that in the book is to think about WPS as a policy ecosystem. And by that, we mean the field of different activities, actors, and artifacts which interact in the name of WPS. So the criterion for inclusion in the policy ecosystem, as we see it, is a performative one. WPS agents are those actors who say that they are doing WPS. So in our conception, the ecosystem always has this referential quality, this kind of acting in the name of. So instead of trying to describe the field of activity from the outside and say, here is what WPS is, and actors have to adhere to that, we look at what actors actually do when they say they are doing WPS in order to try and capture a sort of relationship, a relational account. This also entails that the borders of WPS are porous. Agents can move in and out of WPS depending on how and when they mobilize the language of the agenda. So the plurality of the agenda, as we see it, is therefore inherent. It's not some problem that can be wished away. It's generated by the different accounts, the different politics that different WPS actors pursue. And a bit later in the talk, I'll give some examples of what that means concretely. So the way that we try and pursue that in the book is through a couple of different levels. And now you should see on your screen one of the figures that we have in the book, which is a chart of different WPS policy texts as they emerged in different years, in different parts of the world, and differentiated by the kind of organization that produced them. So one of the first things we do is we look at the totality of these texts produced over 20 years. We're only really interested in the most high-level strategic texts generated by any given entity, whether that's a state, a regional organization, the Security Council, and so on. And that generates for us a population of about 237 high-level WPS policy documents. And we then take those documents and we look through a kind of content analysis at what issues they address, how they do so, and so on. And I'll talk about that in a minute. We then take that policy canopy, that sort of top-level look at WPS policy as a starting point for reading against the grain, which is to say we use testimony, interviews, some close readings of particular plans to seek out the silences, the gaps, and some of the hidden politics of WPS. And then in a final step, we extend our ecosystem model to look at examples of hybridity, grafting, evolution, and fracture, including the overlap between WPS and other policy fields, like the responsibility to protect agenda, like arms control, and so on. So if you look at a figure like this, and if you can sort of follow the regional distinctions at the bottom are not as clear as they could be, but the first column there is Africa, the second is Asia, the third is Europe, and the Middle East, North America, Oceania, South America, and the United Nations is the final column that you can see there. So one of the things that comes out of this analysis, even the ability to count policy documents and differentiate them in this way, is that you get some slightly different stories. The most familiar story to many of you may be the density of policy production in the European column. But actually, if you look at the Africa column, there are some regional organization WPS documents that come very early in the sequence, in the early 2000s, and then a density that isn't always accounted for in standard WPS stories. That's also true for some of the emerging regional clusters in South America most recently, but before that in Asia and Oceania as well. So we do a little bit of work in the book to try and set out that more complex story around who even does WPS. Now, each of those documents, each of those 237 documents, of course, has its own individual history and purpose and narrative. We look in more detail at some of those than others. These are the covers of two national action plans. National action plans, or NAPs, being one of the main vehicles through which WPS is reproduced. There's been quite a lot of scholarship on national action plans in terms of how they present the work of gender equality. Who is shown, as you can see here on the very covers, as the agents and the beneficiaries of the agenda. As an aside, one of the developments we touch on in the book is the increasing sophistication, glossiness, and length of NAPs. They're launched now sometimes to great fanfare. They have their own kind of visual language of what's going on, which is interesting to account for in and of itself. But what we did was that we took each of those documents, each of those 237, fed it into some software, and basically produced counts of the different terminology that was in the NAPs to measure changes over time at that top canopy level. So what we end up with in the book is a number of charts that look something like this. And I won't go through all of them, but I'll just try and give you a flavor of what we kind of produce. So what you're seeing here is the number of references in all of the documents in a set, because this is for all 237 documents. The number of references weighted by the number of documents. So that produces a number which corrects for the increasing number of documents per year. And then within that, different themes as they exist. So arms, climate change, human rights defenders, men and boys, and so on. If anyone's interested in the Q&A, I can talk a little bit more about the detail of that. But what it really produces here is a ribbon which shows you that over time, it's not just that the overall number of mentions to these different aspects, what we call the new issues of WPS. It's not just that they grow over the time, but we can see some important fluctuations in the balance between different themes. So particularly if you look at the second ribbon from bottom, which has this sort of white polka dots, that's terrorism and extremism. So we see a real explosion in references to terrorism and extremism in WPS policy documents from 2014 onwards, really. There are early references, but that's a huge growth, and that squeezes out some other issues, and we can talk about that that balance. So we run that kind of analysis both for the entire universe of policy documents, but also for some of the subsets. So we look at UN documents, regional documents, and then national action plans as three different kinds of WPS policy document. And we think we generate some interesting insights there, although it is worth saying that in every single year and in every single category of document, the number of references to sexual violence always outnumbers the references to everything else put together. So that very standard critical account of the agenda, which is that it's dominated by this fixation on sexual violence, and that many of the more complicated stories of women's agency, of humanitarian relief, and so on, get squeezed out by that. That is also one of the conclusions that we draw. So I can come back to some of that, but just to pull out one of the surprising stories that we think we're able to tell about that, which is that there is this cluster of African WPS, and actually more specifically, WPS, which comes from parts of West Africa. So if you think about Côte d'Ivoire, Guinea, Sierra Leone, and Liberia, all of which issued national action plans quite early in the sequence, basically between 2008 and 2010. Those were the earliest NAPs issued outside of Europe. And they were very linked, at least in our account, to the Mana River Peace Network, which has been noted sometimes as a precursor and inspiration to 1325, but is not really thought of as generating the norms of international society. Whereas what we want to suggest is actually this is a neglected origin point of some WPS. So simple diffusion stories about the agenda don't really capture those surprising complexities. Now, of course, one of the things that you will miss from just looking at what's in policy documents is the various politics that lie behind them, or that require more of an interpretive account rather than just counting the number of words that exist. So I'm going to elaborate on that a little bit in the contrast, actually, between a state that doesn't have a WPS National Action Plan, which is Israel, and then some of the presentation of WPS in the recent NAP of Brazil. So on the one side, you'll see an image that was put out by the Israeli Defense Forces in 2016 on International Women's Day, which we reproduce in the book, capturing, if you like, the idea that Israel is a leading champion of women's inclusion in the armed forces, that being one of the prominent aspects of the WPS participation norm. But as I mentioned, of course, there is no Israeli National Action Plan, and one has been promised for a long time. But there are multiple Palestinian National Action Plans, despite Palestine not being a fully recognized member state of the United Nations. In fact, depending on how you count it, there are three. And in those Palestinian National Action Plans, what you will see is a very large number of references to the unequal gender burdens of the occupation, and of the experiences of Palestinian women and girls in particular in navigating and surviving that occupation. So one of the things we do in the book is we draw out how is it possible for both Israel and Palestine to have some kind of WPS standing, for one of those entities to be treated, at least in the global north, as being more representative of a kind of feminism even though it doesn't have a WPS NAP? And how do we relate that back to the condition at the start of the agenda, in which actually collaborations between Israeli and Palestinian women were cited as one of the great hopes of WPS? This was supposed to be the kind of contact that would resolve the Israeli-Palestine conflict and achieve peace, right? A promise or a form of vitality, which at 25 years distance seems very far away, even absurd in its hopefulness. Of course, today with the situation in Gaza, we can see other forms of the fracture or the diversity that happens under the label of WPS, to put it mildly, in the contention around which side or which acts or which forms of violence in what is happening at the moment qualify as being of feminist concern, of involving gender. There's a hugely gender inegalitarian form of death. We know that the numbers of women and children being killed by the Israeli bombing in Gaza are extremely high, and are likely to only get higher when we take into account excess mortality rates. And this kind of the role of gender unequal death in WPS is something that we treat in the book, which was written before the 7th of October 2023 and the subsequent war. But it's something that we deal with in relation to Yemen and the arms trade as well. But there's a whole set of issues that are implied there. Ask yourself, for example, how many of the governments that cut funding to UNRWA, the UN Relief and Works Agency, after Israel's allegations against UNRWA staff, how many of the governments that cut that funding carried out gender impact assessments on what the effects would be on Palestinian women. So there's a huge amount there, which we can come back to perhaps in the Q&A as well. But I just want to point there to the contentious politics of occupier and occupied, apartheid and militant groups, and so on, which is nevertheless traveling under the common umbrella, common label of WPS. And in the Brazil example, if you take the image on the right, in the Brazilian National Action Plan from a few years ago, at the back, there's actually an appendix of images, including this one of a woman called Maria Quitéria de Jesus Medeiros, who is described in the caption as the first Brazilian woman to join the military. So Quitéria had disguised herself as a man to join the secessionist army of Dom Pedro against Portuguese rule way back in the 1820s. She was born in an area with a high black and mulatto population, and is reported to have declared that she was fighting not only against the rule of Lisbon, but also, quote, for myself, to liberate Maria Quitéria de Jesus from paternal tyranny, from the painful domestic chores, from an unsavory life. Oh, I will fight with water over my breasts for the liberation of women, for the new woman that will emerge, end quote. So she's been hailed as a Brazilian Joan of Arc. And when women were recently allowed, or not that recently, allowed to enter the administrative branch of the Brazilian army, they were called the Maria Quitéria Group. So we do this kind of close reading for a number of the national action plans to draw out the kind of politics that they're asserting. But in this case, what we suggest is that this is part of a kind of projection of Brazilian national identity, which is trying to assert that whatever might be thought by the feminists of the global north, in some ways, Brazil was doing WPS 180 years before Resolution 1325 passed at the Security Council. There's a kind of post-colonial assertion there of a different WPS. We see that also in the case of Namibia, where Netumbo Nandi-Ndaitwah, who is still the foreign minister and now the vice president of Namibia, was very involved at the turn of the century in the generative acts that produced WPS, including in bringing together the Windhoek seminar, which was the immediate precursor event in May 2000 to what became 1325. Namibia's interaction with WPS, its story of WPS, is rooted very much in struggle against South African rule, in anti-colonial movement, and the way that was commemorated 10 years on in these events in 2000 that, as I said, went on to be a stimulus to WPS itself. A condition that is to some extent shared by South Africa to the south, which also has a engagement with WPS, which comes through women's involvement in some of those anti-colonial struggles. And yet, if you read a standard account of the agenda, you'll see very little of that kind of story. So what we're interested in reading Against the Grain is to think a little bit about what it would mean to spend as much attention in WPS talk on someone like Natumba Nandi-Ndaitwah as we do on someone like Hillary Clinton. A final example of the fracture in our analysis, which I will just gesture to, is that under the common umbrella of WPS, we see both an organization like NATO. This is a picture of the then NATO Secretary General with the female defense ministers of seven different NATO member states. The WPS includes both NATO and also some of the feminist organizations, activist groups, including the Women's International League for Peace and Freedom, which are formally opposed to this day to the very existence of NATO. So, what does it mean to treat both NATO and its staunch opponents as actors in the WPS space without trying to say that one of them is the true version of WPS and the other one is the false version of WPS? So that's some of what we try to explore in the book. And as what we conclude with, as Karen mentioned at the start, is this idea or this plea that maybe what we should do is forget WPS, by which we mean simply to give up on the idea of it as a single coherent agenda and instead to focus on the areas of contestation and political struggle that exist within WPS as a field. So to look more at these rival projects of feminist, partially feminist, and even anti-feminist futures, which are carried out by a growing cast of actors. That doesn't really relate to the image that's on your screen, except that we desperately wanted to include it in the book, and we were denied permission by DC Comics, who produced it, and therefore I try and put it in every slide deck I can. This, some of you may recall, was when UN Women decided to have Wonder Woman as an ambassador and produced a series of images to accompany that campaign, only to very quickly row back after backlash, because, as the complaint reasonably put it, that why could they not find a real woman to stand in for the aspirations of gender equality and feminism? So that's the end of my substantive remarks. I'm keen to get into Q&A, but I did just want to mention, especially for participants who are in the United States, that if you go to the Columbia University Press website, and if you're interested in what I've had to say today, you can get the book with a 20% discount using this discount code, and the postage is reasonable enough in the US. It rather cancels out the discount if you're ordering from outside the US, but hopefully that will be something that folk can follow up on if they've been interested in what I've had to say today. But there I will stop. Thank you so much, Karen.
And thank you very, very much. It is, I've myself have so many different questions to ask. but let me just throw out a couple. One, I think that I want to try to sort of take the broader perspective, and one a little bit more targeted. But the first one, my first question that came to mind in reading the book was really sort of, how do we get from here to there? How do we look at this suggestion, or even sort of way of understanding how we are going to realize this ecosystem. So do we need, is it structural? Is it not? Are we essentially, have this organic ecosystem building on top of this sort of structured framework from that has been accepted over the last 25 years? And so do we need to shift our perspective to realize that there's already an ecosystem behind the facade of this singular agenda? Or, is this a matter of reimagining existing policies or structural shifts that need to take place?
Yeah, thanks. I think the crucial thing to say is that Laura and I don't see ourselves as suggesting that WPS becomes an ecosystem. Rather, we're trying to assert that WPS is an ecosystem and probably always has been an ecosystem, in that sense of having the deep contentions within it, which are covered over by this kind of common label. So it's an account of something that we claim already exists. Other people might disagree that ecosystem is the right term for it. I suspect that there will be colleagues, some of them may be on the call, who are very attached to the norm perspective and think it has more value in it than what we are lending it. But a lot turns on who the we is in your question, I think. Because again, Laura and I are not trying to put ourselves in the position of saying this is how policy should be done. And actually, what we're describing, which is an awareness of the contention and the fracture of the agenda, I think is quite common knowledge to people who are practitioners, who are often much more savvy about how they engage with the discourse of the agenda than sometimes outside scholars give them credit for. Actually, it's more of a complaint addressed to colleagues in academia who have perhaps fallen into the pattern of criticizing the practice of the agenda always against the standard of a true version of the agenda as it should be that we are then reaching towards, right? And that has a certain kind of tactical sense, perhaps, or a certain performative sense in itself. But we're trying to break a little bit with that logic of complaining about an implementation gap. So I don't know how much that helps in terms of a structural shift, because I think it depends on how you are situated relative to the agenda.
Yes, I was in New York last week when the UN Security Council held its 24th open debate on the WPS agenda, and I mentioned that we were having this book talk to several people in New York, and the questions posed to me when I mentioned the book talk focused on the hows, right? Sort of, yes, it's all this academic book is all well and fine, but we sitting here, how do we, again, we get back to the question of implementation, perhaps, but how is that shift going to happen? How would you, it's, I guess you say, how would you answer these questions from sort of people who look at, the tactical, the operational, or the assistance at that level of sort of reimagining, restructuring their perceptions of what, how they can, again, in the next 25 years, readjust their efforts at actually beginning to reinvigorate the agenda.
Yeah, I think reinvigorate is a powerful word there. Again, the book is not intended to be a how-to guide, and I think we are both very cautious around the situation in which academics turn up and say to practitioners, "No, you've misunderstood. Here's how to do it better." That's not the business that we're in. I would say, but I don't want to dodge the question either. I would say that I think there is arguably quite a broad consensus that the fundamental typical politics of WPS, by which I mean repeated appeals to the Security Council and the attempt to generate greater traction through additional Security Council resolutions or through additional national action plans. I do think that there is quite a consensus, at least amongst the civil society people that I speak to, that that has become a way of actually draining WPS of its energy. That people end up devoting very large amounts of time to consultation processes, to giving feedback on drafts, to meeting with civil servants and government officials in ways that make them feel like they are being taken ever further from the grassroots on the ground purpose of WPS. So the Forget WPS label is a way to try and capture that and address that. What the solution to that is, I think, again, depends very much on situation. If you are somebody who is fundamentally concerned with getting more women into leadership roles in the United Nations, it may well be that the standard story of WPS works quite well for you. And some of those pressure points within the UN bureaucracy in getting WPS champion states to do lobbying, in thinking about how to reform Security Council practice in various convenings, but that does remain quite an effective avenue to push. And you may find yourself pretending that WPS is more unified than it is as part of your tactical steps in doing so. But if you're somebody who, to again go back to the current crisis, if you're somebody who's interested in accounting for the gender inegalitarian outcomes of the war in Gaza, You are seriously wasting your time at the Security Council. And you're probably seriously wasting your time with WPS champion states. Would somewhere like the International Criminal Court or the International Court of Justice be more profitable? Probably. Do we think of those as WPS sites? I would say quite rarely, although I think you're much more likely to get an accounting through those processes than you are going to get an admission in the Security Council. We have an architecture there, some parts of which, for example, the SRSG on sexual violence, are fairly active in the current conflict. Others, such as UN Women, have actually been quite strongly attacked, at least by the Israeli delegation, and other parts of the WPS architecture have come under metaphorical fire in the war as well. So, in that kind of situation, it's not immediately clear either that having more NAPs has helped the Palestinian side, or that one can address this more generally through a WPS architecture. One of the things we draw attention to in the book is that in the early days of 1325, there was a much greater consciousness that 1325 was one tool amongst many. And the idea seemed to be, if you go back and read some of that early text, that of course the Security Council can't be trusted. We just need to use this as one tool, and when it doesn't work, we'll use different tools. I think maybe what Laura and I are trying to draw attention back to is that kind of mindset, which is less siloed and locked into certain kinds of spaces, which I appreciate is difficult because, in fact, we've had such vitality, there's been so much activity around WPS that some of those avenues are quite deeply trodden.
Thank you. I do have a question which I would like to share with everyone. The question reads, I feel like for practitioners working in this space, especially at the policy level, we are often faced with a lot of negotiations to try to get some form of WPS taken seriously. It is even more uncomfortable for those of us working in the military space, with defense and security sectors. Do you have any advice for how we navigate the WPS ecosystem in militarized space?
And I try not to give advice to practitioners because Sabrina, who asked that question, is probably best placed to know how those stakes play out. What I would say is that I think one of the tensions that we explore in the book is this idea of trying to lay claim to a pure or an original WPS. And from my experience, what a lot of practitioners in military space find is that the greatest success comes when you can present WPS in the most instrumental terms possible, as critical to mission success, as helping the larger aims of the organization, rather than through rights language. And that makes many of us very, very uncomfortable because the version of WPS that we want to cleave to is one which is fundamentally about rights and access, and in many of our versions is anti-militarist and so is automatically uncomfortable about militarized spaces in the first place. But I actually think we need a greater appreciation of those tactical choices and those diverse WPS spaces, and to understand why people use instrumental arguments that are about mission critical success. The only other thing I can think about is that I know that in the UK, there's a movement away from WPS language in training to human security or back to human security. And that's based, at least on the grounds of the people that I've interviewed, on the view that for many people who are in the military, the language of WPS is an automatic turn off and shutdown, especially when you're talking to people who are not maybe engaged in gender training or that kind of work, but are on deployments and get a couple of hours or maybe a day of training in some of these themes. So the idea has been that actually moving away from the language of WPS, but keeping the same content, but framing the modules in a different way, gets greater buy-in, and then perhaps down the line, you get greater understanding. It's probably also helpful, although this again takes us into uncomfortable spaces, to make sure that militarized discussions of WPS are not constrained to women, and that actually you can get buy-in from some more traditional practitioners, if you like, by talking about the ways in which masculinity is also a form of gender, and the forms of gender that men encounter, to stop this siloing. I don't know how helpful those are.
I do have two people in the audience who wish to ask a personal question, a live question. If I could ask Adina Amir, I will allow you to talk. And if you could identify yourself and your affiliation and then pose your question.
Sorry, I might have misclicked something. I've just been listening and really appreciate the talk. I think it's been really helpful to understand a different perspective, especially for me, because I just started working in the like violence and conflict space. So I think it's been really helpful. Thank you for all your work.
Right, thank you very much. If I could then just, Amy Eastman, you also raised, I guess, your hand. If you wish to identify yourself and pose a question. All right. If not, let me go to the next question. How easy was it to access most of the policy documents to create your data set? What were the most common barriers?
Yeah, great technical question. We really tried to start with scratch, from scratch. So especially for the national action plans, a lot of them are in the public domain, but some of the ones that we accessed, we found out about that aren't published. A number of them weren't in English, and thanks to some funding that Laura had, we were able to translate them into English specifically for the analysis that we kind of carry out. So even within what you think of as conventionally WPS policy and NAP, there were some struggles and some issues, but we adopted a code book strategy, if you like, which is detailed in the book, in which we really tried to seek out documents not based on whether we already knew that they were WPS documents, but based on whether they met the criteria that we laid out for including WPS language. And that's how we ended up, especially in the early years of WPS, with a number of regional documents that were about gender and development that came from the Maputo Protocol and some of the regional African documents, which we'd never seen analyzed as WPS, but which do include references, quite prominent references to 1325 and to gender equality. But because in those early days, there was still the possibility of thinking about WPS alongside development rather than as a purely securitized language, those kind of dropped away. And instead, the kind of WPS discourse that we get from NATO and from security institutions sort of took over. So we did our best to kind of seek those out, and to think about regional bodies that were not the conventional ones, think about parts of the world that were not normally discussed in WPS. We made use of expert networks to ask people, do you know of documents that we may have overlooked or neglected? And we went through several iterations. So there is an article version of the argument from a few years ago, which has a slightly different data set involved. We did our best, but if anybody knows of WPS documents that meet our criteria that aren't in the book, and there's a long appendix of all the things that we looked at, please do get in touch for some future revision.
Great. If I may ask, we women in international security, both in 2020 and 2023, as part of this enhancing security project with the U.S. Southern Command, we examined the process of gender integration in military and police forces in the 28 countries in Southcom's area of responsibility. And it's in 2020, most of the countries were in the Southern Cone of Latin America, the larger countries. And in 2023, most of the countries we looked at were from the Caribbean and the Caribbean nations. And one thing that I noticed that made me think very much of the argument in your book came from the observation that many of those small Caribbean nations, first, some of them do not even have a military force, have defense forces or police function in different areas that are also sort of defense forces. And there was very little mention of the WPS agenda or a national action plan. None of the small nations had national action plans, and yet they had national gender action plans. And we could see, through our both our qualitative and quantitative data collection, that there were, efforts and advancement in integrating gender and attempts to, develop gender equality in the various aspects in these forces. And so the question then became, are there are countries then that don't necessarily feel the need for a UN W Peace and Security National Action Plan? And that does that the question then, the going sort of acceptance in the framework as it now exists is that everyone must have or should have the advantages that a national action plan provides for that country. But and yet there are many countries that have made a decision that it isn't necessarily the case. Is this part of what you see is these sort of this moving beyond the sense of a structured agenda and understanding that in each one of these specific contexts that countries can advance in on the different aspects of women, peace, and security in the agenda and advancement of gender equality without having to be conformist in the sense of ascribing themselves to some kind of agenda. But is that an example of what you would see as this kind of very this ecosystem, this policy ecosystem that is not singular, but is very pluralist.
Yeah, I think that's a really excellent example, and not one that I was familiar with in terms of the Caribbean cases. I suppose the distinction would be between WPS, which does, even in its ecosystem version, require that people describe what they're doing as WPS, and this broader feminist piece, which we refer to in the main part of the title. And the feminist piece is much bigger and can take on all kinds of forms. And sometimes those are very strategically not in WPS language, because there is a huge fear, I think, around the securitization and the co-optation that comes with certain forms of WPS. And there is, even as you alluded to there, a very strong identification of WPS with military integration and military gender mainstreaming and so on, rather than a much broader sense of, say, reducing insecurity from climate change. Which is something that we see in the formal WPS ecosystem, but there's a lot of concern around that at large. So yes, very much that's what's at stake in what we're doing.
All right, thank you. Yes, and we'll have one more final question before we turn to the final remarks. And this question is from Mariana Rudenko. Thank you for your push to think critically about WPS since the Russian invasion of Ukraine. Mainly since February 2022, we have observed a lot of pressure on women's civil society organizations in Ukraine to make peace. The International Feminist Peacebuilding CSOs encourage peace negotiations with Russians and women's civil society organizations from Russia. It sometimes looked like pressure. They started to create platforms for discussion. And see, sorry, I just lost this. It sometimes looked like pressure. Sorry, it keeps rolling down. So, was this, it sounds like manipulation with norms of peace building. I didn't read your book, but what advice can you give to the academicians from Ukraine on this point?
Yeah, I think it's a fantastic observation, and is one of the major fracture lines in feminist organization, as I understand it at the moment. And what we really have there is the complexity of a tradition of WPS activism, which thinks of itself as strongly anti-militarist and also as strongly in solidarity with local women, coming up against the contradictions of when local women or women under occupation or women under attack believe in the right to resist through force of arms, which of your principles takes precedence? Your anti-militarism or your solidarity with women on the ground and their particular standpoint? So again, in terms of advice, I'm always a bit reluctant, but I would really stress that the history of WPS, like the history of feminist activism, has always been plural. And there are traditions of feminist armed resistance in the same way that there are traditions of feminist activism. And there are feminist arguments for military resistance just as much as there are for peacemaking. So for outsiders who want to pressure Ukrainian women to take a certain perspective on the war, or who are perhaps a little bit too enamored of the idea that Ukraine brought it on itself, or that Putin would stop if only he was given X territory in the Donbass, or so on, there is a long and rich tradition of anti-colonial feminism and feminist resistance, which is mobilizable against some of that more patronizing and blasé idea of peace, of armed peace.
Thank you. Thank you. So, I want to thank all of our audience and all of those people who sent in questions, and to Paul for his very insightful responses to them. And if I may close with just a final thought to you, Paul, to close our discussion. If we look towards the next 25 years, where do you see the greatest needs and the greatest priorities?
Thanks. I mean, that's a huge one. I think, unfortunately, many of the pressing questions are the same as they were in October 2000, and in some ways, we haven't made enough progress to think about moving on to the next 25 years. Of course, feminism has also moved on and is contentious in its various ways. But I think for practitioners, probably more so than we even realized when we wrote the book, and particularly its concluding chapter, there was a real question around whether WPS will exist in 25 years. Not because it's successfully been implemented and every state has a national action plan, but precisely because it seems to be in a moment of deep, if unacknowledged, crisis. And some of the attitude of even 5 years ago, when people would speak of resolution fatigue as if there were going to be endless resolutions, how wonderful those days now seem with the lack of action that we're seeing kind of across the board. So I think that's going to be the challenge, is what are the different forms that feminist organizing can take outside of this space.
Yes, thank you so very much. Yes, I think that we have a great deal to think about, and the value of your book really is in trying to present to us a different way of trying to approach precisely that dilemma, because there are so many exceptional individuals and organizations working in this field, this endeavor, and there is a great need, as we know, to push back on some of the sort of dynamics that we've been seeing in the past, and the need to continue working on things and finding those solutions. So I think this was a wonderful way for us to again look at the dimensions of what this what our tasks are, right? And to continue the conversation over the next 12 months to sort of say, what can we accumulate more of these discussions, more of these debates and deliberations about how we can try to find a way to sort of reinvigorate, reanimate the need and the way forward on trying to increase closing the gender gap and doing all the things that we need that are set before us. So thank you very, very much. I'm most appreciative, and I look forward to more conversations about this with you and with our audience. Thank you very, very much.
Thank you. Thank you all. Have a great day.